That's all I'm going to say. Now, some of y'all are going to be able to interpret that. Some of you are going to turn around and say, what in the world is that man doing up there? So we can have a proper interpretation and stuff. But just leave it there. So, good morning. Can y'all believe it's December? We're approaching Christmas. Are you ready? Are you ready? Some of you are stressed out, ain't you? You so worried about Christmas and the gifts and all that kind of stuff. Lighten up. It's all about Jesus. That's all it's about. It's all about Jesus Christ. I just want to thank the Lord for so many people doing so many projects this year. So many. I've heard so many good things that people are doing, and it really touches my heart. Last night, they had a, what was that called? Steal a gift thing, or what was that? That was a Christmas party is what it was. Who's going to speak about that Christmas party before I start showing videos? Which one of y'all going to confess? Because y'all need to confess, all right? That's what I want you to tell you. Miss Carolyn? Miss Carolyn?
What happens at the Christmas party stays?
It does until the preacher videotapes it. Then it goes on the wide world of YouTube. Oh, hallelujah. I'm so glad. I know everybody had a good time there. I appreciate everybody who worked so much to just do that. They had 35 there, I was told. There's 35 women stealing from each other, and no one went to jail. Ain't nobody got no black eyes y'all can see up in here. I'm telling you, God's moving. We're in revival. Thank you, Jesus. So if you look at your if you look in your announcements here, you're going to see some different things that are coming up. One is we're still taking up a few things for our Hope for the Homeless. Hope for the Homeless. They're going to be going down to Segan Lane down there in Baton Rouge. And there's still just a few products. We've already done really well with the collections. I am past impressed with what y'all have done. I also want to remind you that we're still taking up a love offering for the carpet and the cushions for the chairs and stuff. So it's a little bit over 11,000, Miss Carolyn, a little bit over 11,000 in there. So it's a little bit over 11,000 in that. And so I want you to continue to, as the Lord leads you to give for that. That's all about getting the carpet and hopefully in the name of Jesus, we'll be able to get the cushions. And even some backrest on there. Wouldn't that be nice? Hallelujah. Just beautifying God's house. It's just a great gift. So praise the Lord for that. Also mentions about the food pantry. And then it talks about our Christmas event that's coming up on December 22nd. There's going to be a program for our children. It's going to be a program. And it's going to be, we're going to have refreshments after that. Please look at that. You got plenty of time. Prepare. You can look at things. Be a participant in it. Encourage our young people as they lead our children in the praise and worship of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. All right, so, Miss Mary.
Hopefully the tree will be empty by the time Christmas is over.
So
thank
you. Did y'all hear all that? Explain the Christmas tree.
Well, there's an ornament. We want you to take an ornament and put a love offering in the envelope for the Lolly Moon Christmas.
So if you just say you don't understand what Lolly Moon is, this is it's a worldwide offering. And I know you say, we're always giving offerings. So one of the things as evangelistic type people, our desire is to spread the gospel message of Jesus Christ, not only in Mount Pleasant, not only in the surrounding counties, not only in this state, not only in this part of the United States, not only in America, not only just this continent, it's worldwide. Come, Lord Jesus, come. So what we do is when you give 100%, so if you put $1 in there, and so you say you feel like, well, I just can't give nothing. So here's what I want to encourage you. If you could sacrifice a Coke this week, one Coke, one Monster drink, that would be, that's more cool now, ain't it? It's the Monster drinks. What's them things cost? $3, Lord have mercy. I want you to think about it seriously. $3. $1.75 for a Coke. And put it in there to spread the gospel message. The Cokes and the Monster drinks go in, and they go to the same place they all go. This message will go with you for eternity. Literally. It would be a great thing to hear someone come up to me and say, when I get to heaven, thank you for giving to the Lord. Because you gave, someone delivered to me the message of Jesus Christ. So I want you to support Lottie Moon, and as the Holy Spirit leads you, just be in prayer. Also, Miss Sue and the youth are going to be doing some stuff. Would you like to mention that just a little bit, if somebody had a name they wanted to announce or something?
If anybody knows of a shut-in or somebody that needs, that's lonely or whatever, needs ministry this season, we're next Sunday afternoon, instead of our youth class, we're going to do a ministry for the shut-ins and those that just need to lift you up during the Christmas season.
Amen. 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 Anybody else? I want you to remember Brother Ellis. His mother had went into the hospital this past week. She is home right now, but I know they're still waiting on some test results. Please keep Miss Margie in your prayers. Just keep lifting her up as they're still waiting on some results. She was in bad pain, but she's doing better than what she was. I believe Brother Ellis, I know he's preaching somewhere today. All this month he has been booked up. There's a lot of pastors that are out. So please keep him in your prayers. And is there anything I'm forgetting? Anything? Remember anything? All right. Let's continue on worshiping the Lord. Oh, yes. Thank you. That's what you got to holler at me about. Yes. Tonight, Brother Jimmy's going to be presented to the church tonight. He was ordained many years ago, and to be voted back in as an active deacon in our church, right? Come and be a part of that as we, he's already doing the work, but we're just recognizing him as a body of Christ and re-voting him in tonight as an active deacon. So y'all remember him in your prayers also, right?
All right, we got Christmas songs today. We don't sing them but two or three Sundays a year, and I want everybody to join with us now as we sing. First song is number 111, Sing We Now of Christmas. Let's stand together as we sing. Sing number 91. I think we can do that with Silent Night, Holy Night. Number 91.
again for allowing us to be here today.
Yes.
We pray that you just bless each and every one of them. And we're here today, Lord, to honor you, Lord. And you let me thank you again for the holiday that's upon us, the birth of your son, Lord. Thank you for that. And we can have eternal life with you, Lord, through your son. Lord, we pray for the ones that lost loved ones during the last few weeks. Pray for them, Lord. We pray for them. Heads around them, Lord, and that they understand what death is about. We could do with our lives what we are able and heal on earth, Lord, to honor you. Lord, we pray for our pastor, his family, Lord. Thank you for their safe trip over and back from Missouri, Lord. Thank you for them. Thank you for Brother Raymond. If he leads us in music, Lord, and our choir, our musicians, Lord. Pray that you just bless each and every one of them. And the ones, Lord, that work in this church and honor you and do your work, Lord, to make things work in our church, Lord. Thank you for them. Thank you for the Sunday school teacher and everyone that has something to do with our church. Thank you for their leadership. And again, we thank you for this church, Lord, and this community. Thank you for everything you do for us. Christ's name, we beg and pray.
Amen. Amen. Angels, we have heard on high. Morning, Jerry. Turn to number 98 there. I heard the bells on Christmas Day. You put that up there for us?
Thank you.
pray. Father, we come to you with humble hearts this morning, thanking you, Lord, for the blessings that you give us from day to day. Lord, it's such a privilege to come to your house and worship you. We thank you, Lord, for being our Savior and for letting us have the opportunity to come and worship. Lord, we thank you for the blessings you've given us throughout this past week. Lord, I ask you to lead, guide, and direct us in everything that we do here today. Lord, may it be done in accordance to your will. Lord, we pray for the ones that's not able to come this morning, that you would bless them, Lord, and touch their bodies and restore them to their health, if it's your will, Lord. We ask you now to bless this part of our service. Be with the gift and the giver. Lord, may it be used to glorify your name. These things I ask in your precious name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Sometimes your music don't go just like you would like for it to. Today, it hadn't gone just exactly like I would like for it to. But praise the Lord, He's here, isn't He? Leslie was going to sing a special for me this morning, and she had sick kids this morning, and she couldn't make it. So I'm just filling in, and I hope this song will bless your hearts. It's an old song, and a pianist not here this morning, and just kind of making do. Beautiful Star of Bethlehem. Oh, beautiful star of Bethlehem, shining afar through shadows dim, giving the light for those who long have gone, and guiding the wise men on their way unto the place where Jesus lay. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on. Oh, beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine upon us till the glory dawn. Oh, give us the light to light the way into the land of perfect day. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on. Oh, beautiful star, the hope of rest for the redeemed, the good and blessed. Yonder in glory where the crown is won. For Jesus is now that star divine, brighter and brighter He will shine. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on. Oh, beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine upon us till the glory dawn. Oh, give us the light to light the way into the land of perfect day. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on. Sing it with me. Oh, beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine upon the slaughtered rim. Beautiful star of Bethlehem is known. Oh, give us the light to light the way into the land of perfect day. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on. Oh, beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine upon us till the glory dawn. Oh, give us the light to light the way into the land of perfect day. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on.
Children's Church. Oh, Children's Church. Where'd Trent go to? Girly, girly, girls. You know, it's a blessing when you hear all the children. It really is. I'm telling you, all across this country today, there's a lot of churches that have no children in it. Did y'all know that? Matter of fact, there's some not even far from here. There's a lot of churches that wish they had a child in it. There's a lot of churches wish they just had someone to play an instrument. We're so blessed. We're so blessed. I'm sitting there thinking sometimes because we get worried about how everything is. It's kind of like Christmas. We get so worried because what if I don't get the perfect gift for somebody? What if I don't get that special thing? I mean, you know, I remember when years ago, this would be way back there. Ain't probably no kids hardly left up in here and stuff. They had something come around. It was called a Cabbage Patch doll. Y'all remember the Cabbage Patch doll? Did you get one? Chrissy, yes. Right? You know, your mom and dad probably had to fight somebody over that thing right there. Probably had a fist fight. Your dad's up in there duking it out with somebody. It's amazing. Because everybody had to have this Cabbage Patch doll. You still got that thing? Is it up in the closet? You mean you ain't got that no more, Chrissy? You know, a lot of these things that we thought was so important at that time went to the same location as a lot of stuff went to a trash heap. It's like a filthy rag. Because it really wasn't valuable, come to find out. It was good that you did it. There's nothing wrong with that. But sometimes we get so stressed over that. So I've been in churches that absolutely would not allow a drum in it. I'm just able to adapt. I don't stress over that stuff. You know, some people stress. I've had them absolutely refuse to have guitars because that was used for the devil's music. I've been in churches that's been without no instruments whatsoever. I've been in churches that had no choirs left. Matter of fact, they'd gather around a piano. Our piano player was much, much, much older than Miss Virgie. She was 88, and she was playing a piano. And we was glad to get together. And sometimes I think as we go about doing things the way that we do, with good intentions, that we forget it's really about pleasing the Savior. You know, worship service is not about pleasing you. Worship is about worshiping our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ with what we have. So they had that little cartoon when I was a kid. It was called The Little Drummer Boy. I guess they have it to be really antiquated today because the animations of it were so stiff compared to today's technology and stuff. And it had the little drummer boy, a little story somebody had wrote years ago about him offering the best that he had was this little drum. It's a made-up story. But the truth that lies within it is it's all about what we're truly offering the Savior. So this is Christmas. And we get all stressed about buying people gifts that it's not even their birthday. So this is when we celebrate our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ coming to this world and giving us the perfect gift. The Father gave his only begotten Son that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. The perfect gift would not even make it on the top 10 list of today. The perfect gift wouldn't even be on all these advertisements. Because have y'all been getting anything in y'all's mailboxes and stuff? So I opened the mailbox the other day, and I must be getting pretty popular. Because I don't know how much they spent on them magazines about that thick. But there's no telling all that slick paper and stuff, because I tried to print up some stuff years ago, and they told me how much it was going to cost. I was like, what? You put that slick paper, and just shoots the price up. So I had saltwater advertisements. Y'all know how often I get to go fish saltwater? If I fish 3 times in 1 year in a saltwater, it's a miracle. But they sent me a catalog that big. They sent me all sorts of, I got advertisements from, what's that called, Wine Country or something like that? It's funny. I don't even drink wine, but I get stuff from Wine Country. I got stuff from chocolate factories. I got stuff from all over, and they stacked up, and I bet you it was around 6 inches or more of magazines and stuff that they wanted me to buy the most perfect gift for my family. And they were beautiful, and they're on sale. I couldn't believe how much money I was going to save. Thank you, Jesus. And we look at it and we put so much stress because we want to give our family something that's so important. You know, the reason that we give Christmas gifts is we think about, you know, the Magi coming and giving the most precious and beautiful gifts. But a lot of times we forget that the gift was Jesus Christ to all mankind. The perfect gift came wrapped up swaddling clothes, which is what? Just a bunch of rags. The perfect gift came and was born in a place. It wasn't the big Baton Rouge general with all these the women's hospital or any of these other big hospitals was born in a barn. The perfect gift didn't come to the rich people with all the positions of authority, but came to a young lady and a guy who did not have positions of power. The perfect gift. You know, Jesus Christ was always teaching to the disciples that they had the ability to always give a gift, and sometimes we overlook it. Sometimes we overlook just how important it is, the gift, and who it matters to. You know, we shouldn't just be givers at the Christmas season. You shouldn't just think about giving for Christmas itself. It ought to be something we ought to be able to do all the time. We should be givers all the times in our lives, especially as born-again believers. So when Jesus was teaching the disciples, he was teaching them in like Matthew chapter 10, verse 8. This is what he says right here. Yeah, go back to that one. Let's start with that one. I'm going to read several scriptures here. That's a good one to start with. Go back to Mark chapter 11, verse 25. We'll go down this list. So whenever you stand praying, forgive. If you have anything against anyone, so that your Father who is in heaven will also forgive you your transgressions. So here it is. This is what it's saying. Whenever you stand praying, forgive. It's something we ought to understand right here. So the most precious gift is being lined up for us, and God is telling us a story right here about what the most precious gift that you can give anybody else in this world. It says in Matthew chapter 10, verse 8, heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. Freely you received, freely you should give. He's telling them something right here. He's telling them something that each one of us ought to have. So we receive something. We give that. We've been given this gift from Jesus Christ himself. Then we ought to be somebody who's willing to give to other people. It says in Luke chapter 6, verse 38, look what it says. Give and it will be given to you. They will pour into your lap a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, for by your standard of measure, it will be measured to you in return. So think about this. By the way you give somebody else, it's going to be given back to you. By the way you give to somebody else, it'll be given to you. And I want you to think about it, because this is so important that we get some part of the Christmas season right. It's so important. It says in Acts chapter 20, verse 35. In everything I showed you that by working hard in this manner you must help the weak, and remember the words of the Lord Jesus that he himself said, it is more blessed to than to. There's some great gifts. Each of us need to give somebody. And it requires something of us. It requires us. You don't have to be wealthy to give the best gift this year. You don't have to be the one who goes up. I seen some different gifts that's been given this year. I seen some kids already driving some really fancy vehicles and stuff, really nice and everything like this. You don't have to have money. I know some kids are going to be getting, you know, everything from four-wheelers and rifles, and there's going to be cars, and there's going to be trucks, and there's going to be all this stuff. And sometimes the parents are so stressed out about what they're going to give. Let me tell you something. If we could just get it down pat for one thing and quit thinking about what all the neighbors are going to measure it by, and just remember, one of these days, we're going to stand before the Lord Jesus Christ. And as we give, it's going to be given unto us. One of these days, it's going to be different. So I want us to consider giving the gift that so many people need to receive. If you go back to Mark chapter 11, verse 25, let's jump back for just a moment. And I want y'all to stand with me today. I'm getting all out of order, but that's okay. Y'all stand with me just a moment. So I want you to think about it. Whenever you stand praying, forgive. if you have anything against anyone, so that your Father who is in heaven will also forgive you your transgressions. And let's focus on that today in the name of Jesus. Let us pray. Father, I thank you so much for being here at this church today. I thank you for this opportunity. I thank you so much, God, that you placed me in the place that I'm at. I thank you so much for directing my path. I ask that you speak to the hearts of everyone today and that you would use me as a vessel to proclaim the truth in Jesus Christ's holy name. Amen. You may be seated. I know I'm throwing you off today because I'm already halfway in this sermon. Look, one thing that we all need to understand right here is we all need something that's so important to us that we need forgiveness. Every single one of us. So when you're out there and you're looking for a gift, one of the things we have to consider is what the need of that individual is. Now, every single individual you know, no matter whether it's man, no matter whether it's woman, it's a young person, no matter what age it is, they need something that's so important. And we all need forgiveness because we are in our sins. Each one of us are sinners that need to be forgiven by the Lord Jesus Christ. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. All have made mistakes. Every single one of us right here are not perfected in ourselves. All of us have hurt somebody. Every one of you, including me. Every one of us have injured somebody in our lives. Whether it's intentional, whether it's unintentional, it's something that takes place. And every single one of us need the forgiveness that God can give to us that can transform our lives. All of us need forgiveness of the people that we've caused to suffer. Have you ever thought about it? See, we don't like to look at this. This doesn't sound like a Christmas kind of sermon, but it really is, because we have to understand, until we realize that we have made people to suffer. You made somebody probably cry. You made somebody's heart hurt. So you got to look at this. Do you need forgiveness from maybe your parent? There's people in their lives, as they were growing up, they made mistakes, they did things wrong, and they never went back and they never got it right. Some people, they need forgiveness from their children, and you might be one out there. And when I say children, I'm not just talking about each one of us as a child, right? Each one of us has a mother or a father. Each one of us has a parent in our lives right here. And sometimes people, I've heard through the years, you know, well, my parents did this, and they made this mistake and this mistake and this mistake, and they had all these different difficulties in their lives. So here's the deal. Don't you think about it. Do you need forgiveness? Some people, they need forgiveness from whether it's their husbands or whether it's their wives. They have injured each other so much that they're walking around in bondage to us. Some people need forgiveness from their friends and different individuals. And some people need forgiveness from total strangers that they hurt needlessly. We need forgiveness. And this is the greatest thing. When God saw mankind, he saw where we were, lost in our sins, lost in all these hurts of this world. He says they need forgiveness. Jesus Christ, when he looked at this world, he was in all perfected of heaven in perfection, and where the angels bowed down, and where the servants were, where there's all this joy and peace. He says, those guys need forgiveness. Somebody's got to pay the price. We need forgiveness ourselves, and sometimes it's so difficult in our lives to look at ourselves and look in the mirror and say, you know what, I need forgiveness because I've sinned and I'm falling short of glory to God. Sometimes you look in that mirror and you know that you've made mistakes, you know that you've hurt people, and you can do a lot. You might be the most compassionate people that surround you, and you can forgive everybody else, but when you look in that mirror, you can't forgive yourself because of what you've done in your life. Matter of fact, you don't like thinking about it. You don't want to ever discuss it. You don't want to ever talk about it because you know you hurt somebody. But if you're not willing to forgive yourself, what you're doing is you're causing unnecessary suffering in your own life. You're causing yourself to carry a weight that God wants to remove from you. And when you're unwilling to accept that forgiveness from yourself, what it does is it can produce this deep depression in your life. It can cause alcoholism, it can cause drug abuse, it can cause so many different things in their lives just because they can't forgive themselves of the mistakes that they made. So as we talk A lot of times the only ones who know that this exists is yourself. See, forgiveness is a gift that every single individual that you know needs it in their lives. It's their most precious gift. Do you know that one of the greatest gifts to one of the greatest hindrances to spiritual growth is when we're not willing to forgive? When you neglect, when you refuse to give the gift of forgiveness to the people that's injured you, that hurt you, that wounded you, that scarred you, the moment that you refuse. Now, here's the thing. We speak it out our mouths, but then you contemplate it over and over. You go over your injury. You go over your hurt. You go over your disappointment. You go over what's happened to you in your life so much. This happened. This happened. This, yes, it happened, but who is it keeping chained up? It's not affecting them. Keeps you in bondage. The people who hurt you that you would like to seek vengeance on, you're not affecting them. And you'll look and you'll tell your friends, I forgave them. And then you ponder it and you over it. And it's like just looking at it. It's like a picture. And you just keep looking at it. And you keep looking at it. And you keep looking at it. And all we do is inflict so much injury on ourselves. Do you need to forgive somebody? Do you need to forgive your parents? There's some children that are so wounded. I've had through the years, I've had to listen to so many hurts in my life, so many disappointments, so many scars and wounds. And people pack it along, and they can tell me step by step and wound by wound and all the hurts in their lives, all the disappointments in their lives, and they carry it in a little bag like a purse of some sort. And it can be a male and it can be a female, and they all carry this no matter where they go because they've never forgave that individual. See, what you need is you need to ask God to give you the strength, give you the ability, no matter what's happened to you in your life, to let it go. Sounds like a Frozen thing, don't it? To let it go. To forgive the people that's hurt and wounded you. Given the gift of forgiveness. Not only will it bless that other individual, but I'm going to tell you the most important is it'll bless you. It'll take those chains that have held you back like Paul and Silas, and it looses you. The prison doors are opened up, and you start experiencing something that you've been missing. People go along and they hold these injuries. Sometimes it can be with a spouse who's done something consistently, a male or female, and it's been over and it's been over. So Ann Landers, she used to write these little reports years ago in newspapers. Young people, they used to have what's called a newspaper. Now it would be on your news feed and on your little phone and stuff like this. But they used to have articles, and they would have basically a gossip section in there. Can you imagine? So Ann Landers, this was a Jewish woman, and she used to write in here these reports. And it was so funny. People were so consistent in reading. And one of the greatest criticisms that people had given her was that she was always telling people to forgive their spouses, no matter what had happened, no matter if they had cheated, no matter if they had disappointed, all the different hurts and injuries. And she would get criticism because she was telling them to let it go. When you're dealing with a hurt and a wound and a scar that keeps scarring you, you got to understand what really matters. So she took this criticism, and she kept recommending to people throughout her whole entire career that they should forgive one another, no matter what had taken place. See, now forgiveness is a Christian concept, you know, from the Old Testament. From if you were reading the Torah, the Jewish law, it would be an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, which would fit in really well with our community, wouldn't it? Strike them back. Burn them out. See, we're Christians, but a lot of times we don't practice the Christian principles, and we actually come up with scriptures, and I'm kind of concerned about how God is going to look us in the eyes one day when we stand before him and we say, well, you know, I believe in Jesus Christ. I just didn't want to practice his beliefs. See, forgiveness
is something that should be more than the concept. It should be something that's in my heart because I know what God has done for me. So do you need to forgive your companion of something? Not, look, if you don't forgive somebody, and some of these injuries go back years and 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 years, what it does, it sours you. Now, you might be still in the marriage. You might still be together. You still might, you know, be in the same household. But that you're living in a sour kind of lifestyle. And what it's doing is bringing harm, not only to you, but it brings harm to your spiritual walk with Christ. It brings harm to your testimony. It brings harm to your life. And you say, I'm so old, or I've been in this so many years. What's it matter now? Let me ask you. If you had a splinter in your finger, would you keep packing it around just because you're not willing to pull it out? Oh, I got a splinter in my finger, and it's getting festered up, and it's causing infection, and it's swollen. Everybody's, well, what in the world is wrong with your thumb? I got a splinter in it. Won't you get it out? Well, I've thought about it, and I really, in my mind, I took it out, but I just don't want to deal with it right now. If you don't deal with it, it's going to deal with you. The smallest splinter causes blood poison. The smallest splinter can cause you to hurt severely. You need to forgive people who've hurt you. You need to forgive people that's even, so sometimes we can do it when it deals with us, but you know, one of the hardest people it is for us to forgive is somebody who's hurt our children or hurt our family in some way, someone who's injured us, and we find that unforgivable because they trespassed. So we was at a prayer meeting one time years ago, and they had a woman come in, and here's what's so strange. When I say this story, I've heard this same story years and years, but this one particular one who came during a prayer meeting, and they said, you know, listen, I want the church to pray for me because what has happened in my life, I can't forgive my son-in-law because of what he's done to my daughter and her babies. I just can't do it. And what it's done, it's robbed me of the joy of my salvation. Now, here's what was so great, is she recognized where the problem was. What her struggle was to forgive that individual who hurt someone who's so precious to her, who hurt the young, who hurt the innocent, and she was holding it so hard. A lot of times we just don't understand forgiveness in the first place. Many times we think that we should forgive them when they deserve it. So let me ask you, do you deserve it? Didn't think about that, did you? Do you deserve forgiveness? How many times have you made mistakes? How many times have you repeated the same mistakes? Forgiveness is not something that me or you can ever be good enough for or earn it. Forgiveness is always a gift. But we look at it and we say, oh, we don't value it. We say we do. But we don't value it because it doesn't come wrapped up in the most perfect wrap. Now think about it. Jesus Christ walked this world. He says, even the foxes got a home. I'm wandering around here. How much clothes did Jesus pack with him? It wasn't the perfect wrapping, but it was the perfect gift that each one of us needed. And it came to us just in time. Do you need forgiveness? See, some people, they punish themselves. They punish themselves because of their faults or their problems. Some people, they because of their past mistakes. They made mistakes in their lives, and they say, I deserve to hurt. And they punish themselves. Years ago when I was younger, I didn't understand. I was so ignorant to so much stuff, and I don't know that I'm a whole lot better. God tolerates me. But when I was dealing with a lot of young people, they had, it was so unfathomable, they had what was called cutters. And you don't recognize it because you're sitting here with, it seemed to be very common with the girls too. But I had guys who've done it too. But it never was out here where I could see it. So I had a young lady, she had explained to me that she would take a razor blade and she would slice herself on the inside of her leg. And she would slice it. And she would slice it. And she says, I'm all scarred up because I was trying to get the heart from my hurt to go to the pain in my leg. And they punish themselves because of whatever reason. Some of you have been punishing yourself. Here's a great thing. When we confess our sins before our Savior, when we confess our sins and turn from our evil ways, God looks at us and He forgives us. He says, He cast it away from us. And He takes me and He says, I love you. But it sure is hard to do it for others, ain't it? It's even hard to do it for ourselves. See, God wants to forgive you today. But you carry that in such secret places. And you got to hit it away in your heart. And you think no one knows it. God knows it. Forgiveness is something that we must give. If we're going to experience the joy of our salvation, it's something that we have to give out that's freely given to us. It's a gift. If you withhold it to somebody who needs it, you do it at harm to yourself. So those people that you have been willing to forgive, those people who've done you wrong, those people who said ugly stuff to you, those people who stole and cheated, they hurt your family, they hurt your loved ones, they hurt all your community, they hurt. Are you going to carry their weight for them? Forgive, lest you be forgiven. Such an easy part of the scripture. But it's a concept as a born-again believer that we have to work at to be able to experience the full joy that God wants to give. There's times where people, they'll go away. You know, I was reading a story about somebody whose child was murdered by somebody, and they forgave them. And here's the thing. That individual turned around and smirked. I've told you about the story about the evangelist that was going around, and his daughter was raped at his home, and this guy that he had tried to rescue, and he brutally raped her, and he had so much hardness in his heart, but God had convinced him that he had to forgive that individual. His daughter was able to after years. But he was still carrying it, and the guy was sentenced to life in prison. So God had told him to go up there, and when he went up there, the guy had laughed at him in his face. But he said he was able to walk out of there without carrying that burden anymore. Forgiveness and forgetfulness are not the same subject. That's not the same thing right here. You see, it's nearly impossible for us as human beings to forget. But Jesus said to forgive them 70 times 7. And I have to remind myself of this all the time. We have to forgive. If we're going to experience the forgiveness it talks about in Scripture, in Matthew chapter 6, verse 14 and 15, it says, for if you forgive others for their transgressions, for if you forgive others for their transgressions, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if, there's that word again, you do not forgive others, then your Father will not forgive your transgressions. So this is where the rubber meets the road. This is where the truth of the word of who we truly are in our hearts comes out. This is a principle of Christianity. See, we got to forgive. If we're going to experience what God has said that we all can experience, we got to give it. Forgiveness is not a price for the Father's forgiveness. This isn't something that you have to have, something that you purchase. It's a condition that we have to meet. See, there's conditions to things in life. So in order to receive it, the condition is we got to give it. And we look at it and we'll say, that's too costly. Really? Jesus Christ hung upon the cross of Calvary. He was beaten. His beard was ripped out. He was crucified for your transgressions. We can't look at everybody else. It was mine. It was your transgressions. And yet, what did Jesus say? Forgive them, for they... Here's the next thing. We know what we're doing. We know what we're doing. I'm telling you right now. You know why? Because I love you. And it's so important. We gotta forgive those people. We gotta forgive those that we've injured. You see, what happens is if we don't do these things, it makes an acid come up of hate into our hearts. You know it. Some of you got that acid reflux, right? Well, you got another acid in your heart, and it's hate. It's unforgiveness. So the most expensive luxury that you can get this year is not a new truck. The most expensive luxury that you really can't afford is a pocket of hate in your life. You have this hate, and it's in your mind and in your heart. And what happens is it's not going to destroy anyone except one individual, the one who's packing this acid. So have you ever seen your car battery, and your car battery would start getting that stuff on top of it, that corrosion? You say, like, why is that corrosion there? I don't see any fluid. I don't see a liquid. But there's this corrosion. And not only is it coming, it's spreading because it's acid. And the acid is there eating away. We got to forgive to prevent the rupture of a meaning relationship, especially when it comes to your marriage. Somebody who's never forgiven a husband or someone who's never forgiven a wife is in some kind of miserable relationship. There's no perfect man. There's no perfect woman. We got to have an attitude of forgiveness in our lives to represent the Christ who paid the price on Calvary. He says, I want you to have life and have it more abundantly. And he's saying, this is the way you have more abundant life, is to let it go. Forgive them. We got to forgive if we're going to enjoy the relationship that we should have with Jesus Christ. Listen, one day we're all going to stand before the Father. Each one of us is going to be held accountable ourselves. Don't bring somebody else's weight and chain into your life. If we're going to enjoy the fellowship with God Almighty, forgive, lest ye be forgiven. So the greatest gift that you can give this year, the greatest gift is something that's been wrapped up and given to you freely. Forgiveness. Every one of us need forgiveness. The most perfect person in here needs forgiveness from God Almighty. And we all should be someone who gives the forgiveness. Forgive your brother. Forgive your sister. Forgive your husband. Forgive your wife. Forgive your mom. Forgive your dad. Forgive your uncle. Forgive your aunt. Forgive your neighbors. Forgive your children. Forgive them. Forgive your ex-husband. Forgive your ex-wife. Forgive them. If you want it, then you got to give it. And you'll receive the biggest blessing out of all of them. If you could bow your heads for just a moment. So as they're coming down to play, forgiveness is available to you. If you've never asked God to forgive you of your sins, listen, you don't need to leave here without that. You need to ask God to forgive you, receive Him as your Lord and Savior. You need to make it public, not so much to get your name wrote down in one of our books. You need to do what God's requested of you. But also as they're playing today, maybe you want to come down here. These altars are open, front, back, left, right. All this stuff's open. And maybe you need to let something go. So I'm going to ask y'all to be patient today. If someone comes down here and prays, can you not give just a minute? Can you forgive them? Maybe you need to come pray today that God would help you to forgive whoever hurt you. Don't care about who sees you or who don't see you. That's between you and the good Lord. But I'm asking you, as my brother Raymond, when he's fixing to sing, I want you to stand up. I want you to come, just come pray. If you can't bend your knees, come sit. I want you to get it all right so that you experience the greatest kiss Christmas you can. Won't you come? Won't you come today? Don't let this stuff hold you back. Won't you come? Come on now. Let the Holy Spirit speak to you today. Won't you come? Won't you come?
Are you weary and worn from its toil and strife? Place your hand in the
Listen, you've carried that weight long enough. Won't you come? Don't carry that bucket of hate no more. Don't carry those injuries. Let it go. Won't you come?
Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. He will keep
Won't you come?
To the end. He's your dearest
It's not too late.
Friend.
Won't you come?
Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Are you walking alone through the shadows?
Can you feel it?
Your hand in the nail scarred.
You can almost feel that pain rising up from people. Let it go.
Christ will comfort your heart. Put your trust in him. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand.
Thank you, Lord.
Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. He will keep to the end. He's your dearest friend. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand.
Brother Sadler, would you dismiss us in prayer, please?
Forgive us. Bless us now as we depart.